Let's welcome in a very special guest at this point of time. Mahesh Patil from Birla Mutual Fund is now joining us. Mahesh, thank you so much for taking out time for us. So every time, whenever we have spoken to you, at least in the last 4-5 months, you've always said valuations are very high, and especially for the broader market space. Is this correction welcomed by a fund manager like you, who is always looking for ideas?
Yeah, so I think any correction, especially when you are getting in money and trying to look at buying opportunities, it's a good time to get stocks slightly at a little better valuations. So while valuations have been on the higher side, I think there are a couple of reasons why the valuations won't come down too much. That's what we believe. One is because the liquidity, domestic liquidity, remains to be pretty strong, and that will continue. Secondly, we have seen that the earnings are currently at the bottom. So it's not like the earnings are at a peak and valuations are also at the peak. So earnings are at a cyclical bottom, and one should see a gradual recovery from these levels going forward. And also the risk-free rate, the discounting rate also is lower than the long-term average. So a combination of these factors would suggest that the valuations will remain high. We could see minor correction in the market because of global factors or some probably more correction in the mid-cap space. But I think these are buying opportunities, and we would look to really buy in this fall.
Right. What will be your call as far as Q4 earnings so far are concerned? I know that, you know, a lot of companies have not declared, but you know, we are more than halfway through to the earnings season. What will be your call on the earnings season, the guidance that has come in from various large-cap companies so far?
So the earnings, Q4 earnings, are pretty much in line, I would say. There have been marginal disappointments in a few sectors, like, for example, in the pharma sector, in the banking space, especially the PSU banks. The slippages have been slightly on the higher side. But there are other sectors, like, for example, consumer discretionary and names where we've seen the numbers to be slightly better. So on balance, I don't think post this numbers, there's going to be any major downgrade. There is probably going to be 100-200 basis downgrade to the FY19 numbers or so, especially in the banking sector or probably in the pharma space, where you'd see that. But I think pretty much, I would say, in line with expectation, at least up till now.
Right. You know, just in terms of pharma, I wanted to understand what do you think is really happening? It's a sector which people wanted to just own left, right and center 1 year back. What do you think is happening over there? Is it in the worst phase of correction or probably last phase of correction?
So the pharma sector has, again, recently we've seen some pricing pressure coming in the US generic space, and that has hurt some of these companies. And the numbers also this quarter have been a disappointment over there. So, yeah, the valuations have corrected. They are one of the sectors where we are looking at the valuations are now probably below their historical mean level. There are very few sectors where the multiples are below the long-term averages. Pharma is one of them. I think there's still no clarity, uncertainty about into what extent the earnings could come off because of the pricing pressure. So the earnings remain a bit uncertain in the FY19 and FY18 numbers. So, yeah, it could be a good time to start looking at it, but given the headwinds, I think one doesn't know whether this is a bottom or there could be some more downside from here. Pharma still remains a more stock specific sector, so there are some individual companies which are doing better, companies which have got unique positioning in the space, strong products, and also a good balance of domestic as well as foreign earnings. So I think could be some more pain from here, but I think valuations are coming down to very attractive levels in the sector.
Right. Also, you know, if you could just tell us about valuations of pharma pack. Now, one of the pharma analysts told us that earlier, you know, these companies, a lot of companies have concentrated products where pricing erosion was never seen. In fact, always price hikes were seen. So their margins went to as high as 20, 25, 30% in terms of EBITDA margins. And that's why historical valuations would not have any big significance because their margins would not be as high. So how do you essentially look at the mean valuations? Do you give it a discount than what it has already been trading at?
Yeah, so I think that's precisely what I was trying to say, that the earnings, what we are seeing currently, whether there could be further downside because of the pricing pressure, is something which is still unclear. There are a lot of noises which are there in terms of, I think we should get some clarity of that. I mean, some of the larger companies are yet to report the numbers, but I think if you look at the commentary from some of these names, we could get some view in terms of what could be the pricing pressure. But there are offsets also over there. I mean, companies have got new products, which could offset the downward pressure in terms of margins on existing products. And there, again, a key thing is in terms of getting resolutions for some of these plants where they have got US FDA warning letters. So to what extent these companies able to really revert back and introduce the new product pipeline will drive the earnings growth. So, yeah, I think for the time being, I think unless we see some kind of a settling down in terms of margins, we should see probably the sector trending below its long-term multiples.
Right. So, you know, we saw this in IT as well, you know, how multiples got contracted, how a sector got derated, you know, just with earnings growth reducing quite significantly. After that, it's been about 2-3 quarters. You've not seen any major uptick as far as, you know, IT stocks are concerned. So, again, after the prices settle down, one has to be aware that, you know, these big pharma companies, unless they get huge positive news flow, they would try and spend some time over there. Again, multiples would start to look attractive only after that consolidation.
Yeah, so just like in the IT sector, what we've seen is that growth has moderated, but the downside is limited because we don't see any major downgrade to earnings over there. So I think that's where the sector has started to kind of bottom out. Outperformance in absolute terms would still remain weak because earnings growth is not very high. It's in probably in high single digits or so. In the pharma sector, I think we should need to still see the earnings over there kind of decline or downgrades kind of bottoming out, I think, which should happen in a couple of quarters or so.
Right. Can you just also talk to us about IT sector? What is the call over there? Do you think they have started to look attractive, or, you know, as a fund manager, you would look at these companies because they have been great value creators, you know, in about last two decades or so?
The IT sector looks, I mean, doesn't look to be a long-term wealth creator at this point in time. There are some headwinds which are there for the sector. And a lot of Indian companies are still transitioning from the traditional model towards the digital world, which is the new kind of era. So we think that the sector, I mean, looks okay at this point in time, should do, can give you around 10-12% kind of an upside, because that's where the earnings growth is likely to be. There is a lot of good free cash flow generation which the sector still generates, and there's a possibility of some amount of buyback, which can enhance shareholder value. So it's a sector which is decent from a downside protection. So if the market's correct from these levels, the sector should outperform. Absolute terms, probably moderate returns is what one should expect. So we are currently neutral on the sector, or probably marginal underweight at this point in time.
Right. And in terms of tech, as you said, that, you know, capital allocation of these companies have changed. You know, but till the time growth returns, they would not start to look attractive even if capital allocation changes happen or continue the way they have been doing?
Yeah, so for a sustainable long-term returns in the stocks, I think we need to see the growth come up. We've seen that in the mid-cap IT sector. There has been a couple of companies have shown a better growth outlook. Again, these are companies which are focusing on certain niches where the competitive intensity is not that high. And we have seen actually the P multiples of some of the mid-cap IT companies now starting to differentiate from the large-cap IT names. So I think that multiple re-rating will only happen when the growth outlook starts to move up from the current range of around 8-10% or so. And that will be only back off stronger U.S. Spends. And as the companies are transitioning and some of these companies are able to crack into some of the larger accounts, we should see that change. But I think it's still some time away. We haven't seen that the growth trajectory, at least for the larger companies, going into at least the lower double digits or so.
Right. You know, we'll go to the financial sector. But just before that, what do you make of the noise around the NPA situation? So, of course, there have been a lot of government push regarding solving the NPAs. But then time and again, you keep getting, you know, after every results, one of the big conglomerate being marked as new NPA. Do you think that this is one thing that needs to be solved for markets to go up?
Yeah, so the banking sector, we have seen a lot of efforts by RBI in terms of trying to empower the banks to resolve some of these NPAs which have been recognized, because one is the NPA recognition, and second is in terms of how soon the resolutions happen so that the bad assets are out of your books and you no longer need to make provisions, you take whatever haircut is needed. So on the resolution front, I think probably one can expect some much speedier action after the new RBI guidelines in terms of insolvency, and also setting up an oversight committee to really enable banks to take decisions over there. So I think that should really help in terms of resolutions. But the slippages in this quarter for some of these corporate banks still remained pretty much on the higher side. So I think the impact of that on the P&L because of higher provisioning and higher credit cost will continue for FY18 and FY19. And to that extent, I think the earnings will still remain a bit depressed, though compared to the decline in earnings, what we have seen in FY17, I think that decline would no longer be there. But the for the ROAs and the ROEs to improve, especially for the corporate banks and PSU banks, will take some time. And yeah, so I think, but I think market won't wait for that. I think market will look at the slippages kind of bottom out. One gets a sense of that. I think the stocks will start to do better from these levels.
Right. So, it's easier said than done, Mahesh. So, we can say that NPA needs to be resolved, but, of course, some tough decisions have to be made. Some write-offs needs to be done. You need to get a lot of capital. So do you think that pain process is what some banks are going through right now?
So the PSU banks clearly are stretched for capital, and we've seen the growth has been very, very subdued over there. And that's, in fact, reflected in the overall credit growth in the banking system, because PSU banks still account for almost 60% of the overall credit growth over there. And so that will remain a challenge. I think government is not going to give easy capital for the PSU banks and would really drive them towards better efficiency and recovery in that sector. So I think it will be a slow and gradual up move. But I think there's a clear divergence in the banking sector. We have seen the retail-focused banks continue to do well and showing pretty good growth. So that divergence, I think, will continue. There will be bouts where we will see some of these PSU banks do well because the valuations are slightly lower. But I think longer term, I think the clear shift for the larger private sector banks, especially retail focus, gaining market share, will continue to drive outperformance in those names.
Right. So if I look at your Birla Frontline, which is one of your flagship funds, the top holding is HDFC Bank, ICICI Bank. Or IndusInd Bank also is among the top 10 names. So do you think private banks will continue to gain market share? That's essentially the theme that you're looking till the time this whole NPA issues are solved?
Yeah, so they've been gaining market share even otherwise, even in the earlier period, when the NPA concerns were not so high. Incrementally, I think the gain would only accelerate going forward. And some of the private sector banks, the ability to access capital is much, much better. Even if they might have some problems, they're easier to do that. So given that, I think this is a clear longer-term trend which we think will only help. And with digitization and digital, how the banks are able to adopt that, I think private sector banks are in a much better phase to do that. So, and also we'll see a lot of some kind of M&A activity in the banking sector, especially banks, NBFCs. We see some kind of a consolidation that within the banking sector. So that the inorganic opportunities for the private sector banks will also be a driver for growth going forward.
Right. Do you like the NBFC sector, Mahesh? Do you think that that's also a sector where, of course, we have already seen a big re-rating that has already happened in that sector in the last 2 years? But do you still think the scope of growth for some of the urban, rural NBFC is still pretty large?
So the NBFCs, especially those NBFCs which are catering to certain niches or under-penetrated markets where the banks are not able to lend through, I think will continue to grow and also able to protect their margins, because banks are trying to get aggressive because of slower growth on the corporate side, trying to really go aggressive on the retail side, and try to, especially in the mortgage finance side, we have seen pretty large aggression by the banks and trying to cut down on the rates over there. But NBFC which are focused on niche areas, catering to those segments of the market which are still not the bank's priority, will continue to expand. And in fact, the NBFCs have been able to really drive penetration and financial inclusion, and that's a trend I think will continue. And we would see at least the larger NBFCs and especially which companies which have got a very strong processes internally to able to grow at the same time, able to contain their credit costs.
Right. But do you think that for banks to do well, for NBFCs to do well, corporate cycle, corporate capex has to pick up? So retail, of course, has been doing well, but you only cannot have retail salary people doing well if corporates are not doing well.
The corporate cycle is also important, but I think we have seen the government spending has been good, so that is also some banks which are probably linked, catering somewhat to the PSUs, should see a decent growth over there. I think first is the working capital cycle will improve, and that's where we are seeing the credit growth will start to pick up, and there are early signs of that happening. And then it's the capex cycle which will pick up. So I think capex cycle would take say another year or so. So until then, the overall corporate growth would be still pretty weak, still in the low single digits or so. So the heavy lifting will have to be done by the retail growth for the overall credit growth of the banks to really be in the say 10 to 12% or so.
So far, when rates were going down, even when it came to working capital requirement, most corporates were looking to tap the money markets. Yes, your ratings matter there, but the money markets also remain pretty alive. So just on working capital, do you see a revival coming into credit demand at all?
So there has been some loss in market share for the banks because of the money markets, and a lot of the corporates are tapping the CP and also the bond market. So the share of that has been increasing, and the bank credit has overall loan growth, credit growth has been coming down. And that trend, can continue. We would see that. So that's the reason why the banks need to explore other opportunities, expand their on the asset side, get into other markets, especially on the retail side, to drive the higher credit growth. And banks which are able to successfully open up these avenues are the banks I think which will do well in the coming years.
All right. So you like the financial space, especially the private sector banks. And you think that you said retail credit has grown well. Now, do you see that continuing? If retail credit is taken for housing, for consumer durables, do you see demand for housing, consumer durables also remaining intact? Would you then like these sectors as well?
Yeah, so these are sectors where the, in fact, few sectors where the growth has been pretty decent. And even the outlook going forward looks fairly strong. If you look at consumer durables, I think we should see good longer-term growth because of under-penetration ownership in a few categories. Also, as the rural growth picks up, we should see a better growth. And more importantly, more people use financing actually to fund these assets, you would see larger penetration again for loan growth in these sectors. Even on the mortgage side, the housing finance side, we see that while the overall new construction has slowed down, I think there is enough impetus and push given to affordable housing, and the measures taken by the government in terms of interest rate subvention should open up pretty good growth for affordable housing in the coming years. And that's again a very exciting area which a lot of NBFCs and banks are trying to cater or tap that opportunity and that segment in the ensuing years.
Right, but is that how you play the theme affordable housing through banks and NBFCs, or do you look at building products, steel, cement, or even the developers who will do affordable housing? How would you play this theme?
So one would play it across the spectrum depending on how the companies are positioned to capitalize on those opportunities which will come in that space, so be it in the mortgage finance area. That not everybody will be able to tap that opportunity because these are segments from a lending perspective, borrowers, okay, who don't have a very high credit profile or not necessarily the salaried class. So companies which are able to really lend to the self-employed, which should be able to benefit more in the sector. And obviously, as the housing demand picks up, the building materials and cement are the other second derivative impact which one could look at.
Right. What would you do with cement stocks or steel stocks? They have come off the lows. Seeing a little bit of correction now, do you think they offer a good investment opportunity now?
Are you talking about the steel stocks?
Steel and cement, both.
So steel and cement, cement has been fairly strong, been pretty steady. We have seen that while the earnings growth margins are still not really really improved too much. Demand has still not picked up, but I think the outlook there looks good. Steel again remains a cyclical. We've seen some recent slowdown or pricing pressure in the China steel market. Iron ore prices came down, but now they have kind of steadied out over there. But domestic steel companies continue to get some protection because of the minimum support prices, and the earnings have been fairly good. So it looks to be a pretty steady sector, but the stocks have now run up. Valuations are no longer cheap what they were, say, around a year back or so. So one has to really watch how the pricing environment globally shapes up, how China does really be to be able to take a call on some of these global cyclicals like steel.
All right. Now, the sugar sector is also in the news today because the government has announced a hike in the fair and remunerative price for sugar. It is a hike of 25 rupees per quintal has come after 2 years. Would you view the sugar companies positively now? The cycle is in any case already started to turn. Or does one have to be more stock specific and selective there, seeing their balance sheets, seeing the location of their sugar companies' factories?
Sugar is one sector where we haven't really done any kind of big, we haven't really played that in great detail. This has been a good year for the cement sugar companies. But again, these are the sectors where one should actually buy them when the cycle is weak. The bottom should be really careful because we've seen this cycle, sugar cycle, normally play out, say, over 2 to 3 years, and then there is a downturn over there. So, I think broad macro call, I think we are probably somewhere in the mid of the cycle, a bit careful over there. I think one has to really then focus down more on stock specific and to see how, what stability, okay, one can get in those stocks, because the cycle is pretty much, I think, played out. There could be still some more this thing, but it's probably peaking out.
What about stocks in the infrastructure space? For them, the cycle seems to be near the trough at this point in time because the government spending on infrastructure is increasing. The same is not happening with the private sector. What would you do with some of the infrastructure names?
The infrastructure sector is, looks interesting at this point in time. There are a few areas where clearly we have seen good order build-up, especially in areas like road. We have seen construction activity has picked up. There are good order inflows over there. Railways has picked up in the last couple of quarters. Companies catering to that have seen a meaningful increase in terms of order inflows over there. The urban infrastructure projects are also doing fairly well. And going forward on the CapEx side, we have seen the oil and gas sector slowly starting to really pick up in terms of CapEx. Initially, it is for catering to the BS6 norms, but further greenfield or capacity expansion in that sector should also start to happen. So these are the areas where on the broad infra and industrial CapEx where we are seeing a decent improvement in terms of order book. But the power sector still remains pretty subdued, especially the thermal sector. And even the large investments in the metal space still is some time away. So, yeah, I think the sector looks a bit encouraging, but it's not across the board. I think companies which are catering to the sector, and also the T&D sector, so the power T&D sector, especially transmission and distribution, where there is, again, significant investment which is happening. So if you're able to really identify companies and segment within these sectors, catering to these sectors, I think there is likely to be a very strong build-up in terms of order book and top-line growth in the coming years.
All right. So here in infrastructure, then how would you pick? Would you pick those companies that are large EPC players and have a strong order book? Because some of these companies still have a lot of stress on the balance sheets.
So again, in the infrastructure sector, we'll stay away from companies which have got stretched balance sheets because they will not be able to really get the incremental orders. Companies with stronger balance sheet, because as the business grows, I think they will need to really reinvest. Working capitals will go up, and the stronger names, and especially companies which have present across the driver spectrum. We won't like to invest in companies which are focused only on a particular vertical, because we've seen that demand or outlook in a particular sector can be a bit cyclical. So companies which have got presence across some of these verticals would be better positioned to do well and capture opportunities in as they come up in some of these sectors. So large EPC or medium-sized companies with strong balance sheets and present across the verticals would be the preferred place in the infrastructure sector.
Right. Mahesh, you know, in terms of infra or, you know, any other play, can you just tell us that asset-light model is what you would look at? That's what the market is now favoring. So again, look at companies which are asset-light, which have good brands or which have built in good brands over a period of years.
Yeah, so companies, so I think we will see as the industrial capex pick up, companies which are slightly asset light and especially which have got pretty good strength in terms of not brand but also in terms of technology or products to cater to the differing needs. Like, for example, there is new markets opening up on the renewable side, for example. Companies which have the products to cater to that segment would do well. So, and again, the investment, a lot of the companies have still got enough capacity. So the incremental growth which will come in won't require any kind of investment. So the operating leverage and the overall return ratios for these companies can improve significantly from these levels. Compared to some of the companies which require heavy investments, asset owners, for example, which will require capital. But there again, the fact that with interest costs have come down and also for some of these companies are able to now deleverage. We've seen some of the asset owners being able to take off the assets from their balance sheet by way of InvITs, which we have seen that. So they're able to tap the secondary market as well as the private equity investors to offload the assets and to bring in cash that they can pump in back into the business and grow without requiring any significant capital.
Right. Also, you know, you get a real-time update as to what's happening as far as SIP culture is concerned, flow into equity is concerned. With the recent correction in the last 8-10 days, do you see anything has changed? Do you expect domestic flows to be strong?
So the SIP flows continue to remain pretty steady. We don't see any major change over there. Despite the market volatility, even the recent volatility, we haven't seen any kind of change over there. The large ticket flows can be a bit lumpy and can get impacted because of market sentiment. But the SIP book itself is now close to 60% of the total inflows, or somewhere around 6,000 crores on a monthly basis. I think that should continue, and we don't see that really getting impacted, because even if the markets correct more from these levels, I think that trend looks to be pretty strong and much more resilient.
Right. Just a word, you know, a lot of people were waiting for correction in the market. You think if somebody wants to do a SIP or starts a SIP for, say, 3 years or 5 years, really market correction would not matter over the 3 or 4 year period of time?
Yeah, so somebody looking, having that kind of a horizon, I think the market corrections would be there, but I think they should again be able to come off from those levels. As long as the broader economy and the outlook remains pretty strong and improving, and we are pretty constructive on things improving, I think the GST is one more thing, which is short term, yeah, it could lead to some kind of a disruption, but again, good for the longer term. So the macro outlook for 3 to 4 years looks fairly good. And the corrections, whatever we come in intermittently, is something which should not really bother investors. And especially if somebody is coming by the SIP route, I think the corrections would only be opportunities to really average out at lower levels.
Right. Mahesh, thank you so much for taking out time for us. Always a pleasure talking to you.